Joining me right now to discuss this and more, the former acting director of Immigration and Customs Enforcement, John Sandweg. John, thanks for coming in.
Yeah, it's good to be here.
Thank you. The head of Customs and Border Protection not only said it was devastating in speaking out this morning about this tragedy of this 8-year-old and the 7-year-old who passed away in their custody, but he also said this morning that their facilities just aren't equipped to handle families and young children. And he blames Congress for that. Is that what you saw? Is he right?
He's definitely right about the facilities themselves. These are short-term lockup facilities that were designed to house adults and frankly house them for just a few hours. They were built with the initial, what we were dealing with at the border up until about 2015, which was primarily people from Mexico crossing into the United States who could be deported quickly. In no way, shape, or form were they designed to hold 7-year-old children, much less 7-year-old children for what's now, you know, days. So this was inevitable, quite frankly. You take vulnerable populations who are under incredible duress and you put them in facilities that weren't built to house them. No matter how deeply the CBP officers care and how much attention they pay, something like this was just going to happen.
You know, after the 7-year-old girl died earlier this month, I remember you saying that if not for the fixation on detention, I think is how you put it, coming from federal authorities, then that little girl would probably be alive. What then is the answer to when families cross the border illegally? If the facilities aren't up to it, right, and detention, you say, you know, isn't helping them, what is the solution, do you see?
Well, look, we can be tough at the border and ensure that every single one of these people are placed into deportation proceedings and returned to their home country quickly and still release them. And that's the solution. We continue to spend hundreds of millions of dollars to take 7-year-old children and put them into very dangerous situations where, you know, the CBP positions themselves to get blamed for this child's death, no matter, you know, it's quite possible the child was so ill that there was nothing that CBP could do. But just by having custody of that child, you own and you are fully responsible for that child. Yeah. Why would we take a 7-year-old child and place him in detention when we can put him into deportation proceedings, hire some immigration judges, expedite these hearings, and if they're not eligible for asylum, return them to their home country quickly? It makes very little sense to me why we're doing this.
And to your point, I want to play for you what another former director of ICE under President Trump, actually, Tom Horman, what he actually said this morning about people, I don't know if they're quick to blame Border Patrol agents for what has happened here. Listen to this.
Let's not vilify the men and women of Border Patrol. They're doing their best.
Yeah.
These people are coming from third world countries. At our family residential centers, when we have the mothers and children there, many times the first pediatrician that child has ever seen is the one the government gives to them. I can't tell you how many people that Border Patrol has turned over to ICE custody that immediately go to a medical trauma center. I mean, these people are in bad shape.
John's Tom right?
Yeah, Tom's right. I mean, Border Patrol, listen, I've worked with those Border Patrol agents along the border quite a bit, and I'll tell you, they care. They're going to do everything they can. They're just put in an impossible situation. They are not medical professionals. Right. And you're now putting 6-7-year-olds in, facilities that are small, that are designed to house adults, and frankly, they're not designed to house them even overnight.
Yeah.
And now you have these children there, and look, no matter how deeply you care, and I believe 100% they care, and they're doing everything they can to protect the health and welfare of these children. You've just put them in a much higher risk situation, and you put them in the Border Patrol in an impossible situation. There are other ways that are just as tough at the border to deal with this problem. I just don't understand why our reluctance and why we're fighting the legal framework that's worked for decades in order to shift to this mandatory detention approach when we don't have the resources, the facilities to do it, and now, you know, you have 7- and 8-year-olds dying as a result.
I mean, it's just so horrific. That it would have to come to children dying. Yes, even if their parents come over here illegally, the reasons they come over are varied. But the fact that children are dying because the process is broken and then they can't get their act together to fix it compounds the tragedy. Real quick, I want to get your take on the other thing Nick Valencia was talking to us about, that ICE is dropping hundreds of migrants off at these, almost it seems like at random in parts of Texas, bus stations and restaurants, not even giving the heads up to local authorities. ICE, when asked about it, said that they have nowhere to hold them, kind of to our discussion about detention. There's got to be a better way. Is there?
Yeah, this all should be a much more orderly process. Now, and honestly, what I point the finger at is this kind of insistence that we're going to take these families. Look, the threat along the border shifted. I use the term threat just like what DHS would use, right?
Yeah.
Historically, what we've seen are single males, primarily from Mexico, across the border. They try to evade capture. Beginning in 2015, you began to see this massive uptick in Central American families who want to present asylum claims. I get where people's frustration if they think it's a loophole that they get to take advantage of. The reality is it's not. But what is true is that we've never adequately resourced the immigration kind of, you know, enforcement system to handle large numbers of families. And instead of, you know, addressing this problem, look, I get what you're saying, too. People are frustrated that these people take their children on this very difficult journey. But from where we sit in the United States, the practical reality is they're coming, and we have to deal with it. So let's deal with it in a way that's efficient and safe. And that, in my mind, what that is, let's stop fighting this, and let's go ahead and resource up the immigration courts so we can have fast asylum hearings. If you're not eligible, you get sent home right away. But building this all this detention facilities, what it's done is overwhelmed the system. It helps, it prevents ICE and hinders ICE from deporting serious criminals. And now you're getting families dropped off scattershot along the border. There's no coordination or insufficient coordination with the aid societies that'll take those people in, the advocacy groups, and we'll try to at least help, you know, integrate them back into a place while they wait for their deportation hearing, and you have 7 or 8 year olds dying. I really think it's time to stop looking at shortcuts like new regulations that, you know, will eliminate the need to see immigration judges or trying to rapidly build out, you know, camps that can house families. Let's just hire the immigration judges, fast track these hearings. It's a pro-enforcement approach, but it's one that's a lot cheaper for the taxpayer and a lot safer for the migrants.
Well, that would come with a conversation of Congress actually working together to have this kind of thing happen. But John, thank you for coming on. Unfortunately, I think we're going to have to talk a lot more about this coming up. I really appreciate your time. Thank you.